Great. My name is Glenn Johnson. I'm here with my colleague, Dylan Shumway. And we're are going to talk very quickly about the project that we were working on. Boy, this is about a year ago when our grant expired. So what we wanted to do was we wanted to take advantage of a resource that we had in our department out of the Statistical Consulting Center, where we were able to gather case information that would allow us to support higher order thinking as our students are in their capstone course or before then, to look at ways to look at statistical consulting situations put that into a format that our students and our faculty would be able to take advantage of. The archives.
Yeah, in our consulting center, we've been collecting project data for quite a few years, and it's basically been sitting there, but we recognize the fact that these could be retooled and reworked to take experiences in statistical training beyond simple textbook examples, to put the students through the process of decision-making and problem-solving within the context of a consultant-client environment. So these projects are sitting there, and we're in the process of sorting these out. And Glenn has kind of devised a scheme for sorting through these, and I'll let him describe it.
Well, if you watch the, I think it's One History Channel show, where they're looking for gold, they talk about a wash plant. And so we have literally thousands of cases to go through, hundreds of cases perhaps. And so we have folks in the department that are going through and looking for appropriate cases and trying to look for ones that are potential. We had outlined an interface, a simple interface that would allow us to present these to students and give them opportunities to submit ideas and discuss amongst each other what they found, what the results are, and then be given a second level for each of those cases. Where we're at right now is that we've come to find out that the cases, to rate the cases, is a lot more work and a lot more time intensive than we had ever imagined. Where we're at right now.
Yeah, in the process of doing this, what we're really finding is that there are some of these cases that are very straightforward. We can see what the client had proposed, what they needed in the way of statistical help, and it's kind of a cut and dried process, and that doesn't really make for a very interesting case study for a student trying to learn the process. So in the analogy of the gold wash plant, we're looking for the platinum and some of the more valuable ones. Ones that have twists and turns, some things that may be unexpected, maybe some communication breakdowns in the historical files that we're capitalizing on to try to find the really interesting projects in the past to develop those as the most informative for case studies.
Wrap up the because I see the sign there, very good. So to wrap up, even though our grant cycle has passed, has gone by about a year, the energy and the excitement that this has given us to take a look and include this as part of our program has not gone away, and we don't want that spirit to die. Contemplating putting in a second grant to, you know, boost that as well, but we're going to continue on with this.
Okay, hello, I'm Kevin Sparks. I'm a master's student here on behalf of Alex Klippel, and we're from the Geography Department. I'm going to talk to you today about sketch-based geospatial learning objects. So in order to deliver dynamic rather than static educational content, our objective was to create a library of sketch-based learning objects for geospatial concepts to be made accessible for educators and students alike. In order to do this, we came up with a list of relevant topics, and for that we looked to the Geographic Information Science and Technology body of knowledge. This began in 1997, finished up in 2006, and this body of knowledge presents information on a wide variety of information. From analytical methods and data modeling to GIS and technology and society. It's become an important reference in both the professional and academic environments, and talks about topics from geographic information systems, remote sensing, satellite navigation, and cartography. So once we came up with our list of relevant topics, we had to evaluate existing software solutions. For that, we came up with a list of relevant features that we needed to satisfy, seen along the column headings. We then compared a couple different applications, and as you can see, we ended up deciding upon the Explain Everything application from the iPad. It ticked the most boxes. There are other more advanced hardware and software solutions, but they are ridiculously expensive, and we skimmed over that. So making the sketch-based learning objects accessible, we have an open access library of these sketch-based learning object videos. We're looking to reach out to other geography-related classes to incorporate them into, and mentioning classes, except for integrating the sketch-based learning objects with other media. We deployed these videos in a class last semester for advanced geospatial analysis with large amounts of success. We're taking these lessons learned from last semester and trying to incorporate them in a class this semester, and looking to do even more overhauls next semester with this same class. So a minute left. I'm under time. Thanks.
Okay, good afternoon. This is our project. My teams are Michael Provoso, Darce Lee, and Shen Lee, and myself. So I will talk about the project exploring innovative framework of involved best practice for effective online learning. So the questions here we had at that time, how we can compensate for the missing on-campus pedagogical engagement. So that was the focus. So essentially, you can see the question here is when and how we can facilitate that, you know, online discussion, assignments, work, all that kind of stuff. That's just very specific. So the in terms of the research, what we did, you can see the bottom here, we had the modules, you know, we have 7 modules divided for our course. So we try to do, you know, module by module to see the activities, learning activities from students, and to see what we can do. So that's why we can see here how we can have students be better engaged in the learning process. So we had the pre-class survey and as a post-class survey. So basically, you can see here methodology-wise, this is an approach we took. So essentially, we use structural equation modeling to understand that factors, what factors matter most in the during the process, and also to see the individual behavior, you know, because we like to see all the students that are doing well. So we have to see the detailed activities, the insights of the class, so we can make it a change. So basic here, the first step where we did, we collect a lot of it. You can see the 6 classes we did, and over the time, 2 different classes. So essentially, we create this a bunch of questions we ask the students before the class and also after class. So we understand the what matters, like I say, the for the student engagement. So here, of course, you can see once again student interaction that matters, and how we can enhance that online environment. So the second part, of course, you can see here in terms of a faculty and student engagement. So we understand there's many things we can do, of course. So we stay on focus, and essentially you can see here, you know, the students, the posts, the how many activities, the posts and replies, all that kind of stuff they have done during each module, and see the outcome. And here, what matters most, and you'll see the dynamics during the online class. So anyway, back to here, so you can see the highlights here, so when and how we can change that, the interaction, enhance the interaction over the course. So we made a change based on what we understood, so we did another 2 courses. So essentially, we just took the understanding, made a change, and then apply that change to new courses to see what is outcome. So wrap up here, you can see the outcome here. The highlights one thing, and by making change, we do see the activities change significantly. So students is more engaged, and also you can see in terms of do they like teamwork or not, specifically teamwork. actually, we did see significant change here. So they like to be working on team project because the change we made. Because typically, students, they don't like work on team project, even you ask them. They say they like to work on team project at work rather than schoolwork. But the change we made based on what we found as a method, they do like what we made a change. The change we made, and also they're more engaged. So that was our focus. Thank you.
I'm Shannon Cannon. This is Paula Bigatelle. We're part of a research team that has members from Penn State as well as Kennesaw State University and the Open University of Catalonia in Spain. And this is an ongoing research project that we've kind of evolved over time. So this is the evolved version that we're talking about today. That's our research team with pictures. Yay. The two basic components of our project are looking at how students rate teaching behaviors that the students find helpful in the online classroom. And then we also, this time also, are looking at faculty perspectives on what faculty believe are important in the online classroom. So we have done some very initial statistical set stuff. And we have 82 points of statistical significance, but we don't have a lot to say about that yet. We have a lot more to do with that, but we do know that we have some things that we can investigate. And in particular, we're seeing differences between what faculty rate, how faculty rate things and how students rate things, and differences between the Spanish populations and the American populations. And we're also seeing some differences with demographics. Some of the notable ones right now are age-related differences, and that might speak to what we know about adult learners at this point. And then I think there's some cultural differences in the educational systems between the Spanish Open Catalonia students and the students at Penn State and Kennesaw that we're going to look into as well. And for our next steps, we are actively seeking a structural equation modeling expert to join our team. That's my promotion. So we do need to do that for our next phase of the data analysis, but we've collected all the data, we've got it all ready to roll, we've got our hypotheses, we just need to analyze the data now, and then we'll have something very exciting to report at the next session. So Paul is now going to talk about how this is going to translate into the real world application, which is the important part.
Yes, we want to see how theory moves into practice and actually have an application in the real world in the classroom. What we had an opportunity to work with a faculty from IST who was interested in our work. So she wanted to take her students, 59 students, give them the survey, the interview, which contains the 35 teaching behaviors that relate to the competencies of online teaching success, things that the faculty can do to help students succeed, in other words, and then this profile that gives us an insight into the students, we don't want to call this a learning style, but we want to call it their insights into things like motivation, their self-efficacy, their control and initiative. And so those four variables are in now, which is called self-directed learning. And we know what the research says about self-directed learning and how important it is in online learning. So we have an opportunity, and we've collected data with these students. And what we're trying to do is see if there's some kind of matchup and pattern between those students, for example, that are, let's say, high in initiative, high in control, and is there a pattern of the teaching behaviors they consider important in their online learning. So that's going to show us promise in application.
So yeah, I was asked by Conrad Tucker to show this talk today. Essentially, what he's interested in is if you want to manipulate objects in a digital world compared to a traditional handheld or hands-on learning style, how does that affect just the student's performance and everything? So to do that, he is essentially working on different sets of students, an online course and an in-class course, where you are essentially either where you're essentially going through the same project, but in one group you are seeing a 3D representation of an object, and you can do teleconferencing between students, and you then make a presentation all virtually and do prototyping as such. Compared to, again, how students in the engineering course normally do this with real objects, in-person meetings, and physical prototyping. This is something you actually didn't look in, which is, of course, online software. You might have these kind of issues where you are communicating with others, but things just go horribly wrong. Again, something that you have to think about if you're trying to do a large online course. I guess compared to in-class courses where you do occasionally have people's phones go off and whatever, there are benefits. But yeah, so one of the things you worked on with this COIL grant specifically was a haptic feedback. So this is a glove they developed, and essentially you can get feedback.
I got it.
If you try to grab stuff with the hand, it will actually stop you from clenching your fist. So if you wanted to combine this with, say, a Kinect, you could actually reach out and touch something. It's pretty much what he's showing off now. There's no positional tracking built into the glove, but this prototype is working just fine as is.
I think it's meant for people with slight.
I'm not sure if you're going to see this video that you really want me to show. But,
I think nades are a little bit bigger than most people.
It's just a binary for each hand, for each finger. But again, this is just a prototype. They're working on a more advanced one that will give you individual joints and at least for different axes of motion. I think that's about it. There's a patent on the device, or there will be soon. I don't know how long Penn State tends to
take. Thanks, Bart. You just texted me, I hope. Okay. My name is Ann Clements, and the title of this is Committee on Institutional Cooperation, MOOC. And it's interesting because Penn State is a sister member of the Committee on Institutional Cooperation, which is the academic arm of the Big Ten. And while we have the most amazing and largest infrastructure in higher education in America, it doesn't trickle down to those of us who are on the ground teaching every day. And so this project was, how do we utilize the power and strength of the CIC in our classrooms? And so we actually had a change of title. And we weren't really going for a MOOC approach. We decided along the way that we're looking for a DOC approach, which is a distributed and open collaborative course. So while we're maintaining the social infrastructure of a MOOC, instead of one group or one person or a small group of people teaching to the masses, we thought, can we flip that and have the masses of faculty in the CIC teaching to the students of the CIC? And so we've got a great team representing e-learning in arts and architecture, as well as ETS and the School of Music. So the concept, again, is partner with music education faculty from across the CIC to create a series of collaborative learning modules that leverages the specific expertise found at each participating institution. And there were three levels of participation in this project. The first was simply to contribute content. And the content started with a 4 to 7 minute long video excerpt of an area of expertise that a faculty is willing to provide us that's specific to undergraduate education. And then we constructed curricular materials around those video modules. And now we're in the third part, which is to actually have faculty in the CIC use these modules within their classes. I hope this will work, but I don't know if it will. So this is what the intro looks like, really fancy. And you can find us on musicedseries.org. And we're using SHIB so that all faculty and students in the CIC can log on using their institutional authentication practices. And it looks like this. Participation was outstanding. I was hoping for 10 faculty. We have over 30 faculty participating who created over 40 modules along with assistance from graduate TAs here provided from funding from COIL. And the modules are comprehensive and they are based on both content and the social interaction. So you can watch Tony Leach and then a student at Northwestern can pose a question that Tony could respond to, or students at Indiana could respond to, and hopefully we'll gather some social web there. We also built in a digital badging initiative within this using the Penn State digital badging platform. In music ed, we just came out with new national core arts standards, and these have been incorporated. Every video module has one project that can be, the end result of the project can be added to your goals of reaching a potential badge. And so the outcomes are still yet to be seen. It was launched on Thursday of last week to a live audience of 100 music education faculty from across the CIC who were here on campus, and it was very well received. And our next steps and hope for community involvement is to find more permanent funding so that we can expand this and perhaps move beyond the CIC to the world and have faculty across the world contributing to this. So thank you.
So we were part of the second round of COIL funding. We had a group of people around Penn State looking at learning analytics. And what we did is we tried to figure out how can we kind of get our feet wet in a project here around analytics. So we went into the data warehouse and pulled a list of courses that were high enrolling, low success. So we looked at this list. We went out and talked to a lot of faculty members to talk about learning analytics and whether they'd be interested in partnering with us. And we ended up working with Math 110 on this project. So we had a lot of different people here. We had Math 110 instructors from the Eberly College of Science. We had different people from the College of Ed helping us with data visualization and ed psychology. Several members of ETS, TLT Studio, TK helped build the software that I'm going to show you here in a minute. Nick Warhalak, he was our statistician from the Office of Planning and Institutional Assessment. Andrew Fisher, he helped us with the Angel data. And after I sent this off to Brad to be put into this deck, I kicked myself because I forgot two of our graduate students that helped a great deal here. Josh Choi as well as Tao Yang. So we had quite a bit of people that kind of moved in and out of the project, but this was kind of the core team. Essentially what we try to do is grab a bunch of disparate data sets that people interacted with as part of their Math 110 experience and then give it back to the students in a way that can help them make better decisions. We use this metaphor of a mirror. We really just wanted to hold a mirror up for a student, allow them to see their data and kind of compare their data to groups of other students in order that they can make better decisions. How they're going to prepare for different aspects of Math 110, predominantly examinations. So we did this in two steps. We did what we called day zero predictions. So before a student even set foot into Math 110, we were predicting their grades. We were doing this with a lot of data they provide on their application to Penn State, SAT scores, high school math scores. Our admissions office actually runs a predicted GPA for every student, both science and non-science. We use that data. So we collected all this data, and based on this data, we put students into risk groups. So high risk, medium risk, and low risk, depending on how likely we thought they were to pass or fail the course. So based on that, we then put them into kind of these peer groups. And then within peer groups, after each exam, we allowed them to kind of look at their score on an exam and compare it to other students. So what we're seeing here is someone that got a 65 on exam. This might be exam one. I'm not sure which exam we're looking at here. But the student would log in. They'd see this interface on top of Angel. It looked like they never left Angel. They'd see what they got. And then they can click up and down these grade bands, and they can start to compare some of their interaction patterns with students that got a B, a C, a D, and so on, to kind of just see where they are. We didn't feel very good about making recommendations or prescriptions based on this data yet. This is a research project. We're trying to understand that better. So we kind of stuck with this idea of let's just show them their data in a new way they haven't seen before and kind of see what decisions they make of this. So we're trying to kind of find out more now about what's actually happening. So we ran this once. We had 126 students use it out of about 600. We have some anecdotal evidence that students that used it performed better, but there's nothing really causal we can say yet. We're still looking into that. And we had some survey questions on the interface as well that we were using. And next steps, we're launching this at World Campus right now with the World Campus instructor of Math 110. We're analyzing new data sets in resident Math 110 because every time new data comes, you have to rerun your models. And in terms of involvement, we think we have an interesting process here now. So if other people have a lot of data they want to look at and see how it impacts students in the course, I think we have a method that we can do that and we can help with. Thanks.
So who's watching the watcher, I thought. Yeah, I better get up here.
IRB was not fun.
Okay, thank you. We had only one rig that was not able to join us today, and I said I would at least share with you their slides. And I'm afraid I don't have a great amount of depth in this, but we'll just walk through it. So this was in round two, I believe, and this was Carlene Maitland, who's always been very interested in the idea of how do these systems affect students in developing countries, and Eric, who we'd hoped to be here but wasn't able to make it today. So I'm going to fess up. This is the first time I'm seeing these slides. So, and you can read as well as I can. It looks as though they are working with some national agencies, American embassies, U.S. Department, and I know that they've been looking at how they can extend the resources of the university through a MOOC to developing countries. So let's see what she tells us. They participated in a MOOC camp, and it led to social and cultural capital for students and embassies. By capital, I think she means relationships, I'm hoping, and extending Bordeaux's capital, it must be a cultural capital, it must be a theory. Embodied cultural was broken down into four categories. Looks very interesting. I hope I'm really butchering her project. So she submitted a manuscript to Information Communications Technology Development Conference. I do know that she's presenting, I think tomorrow, she said, at the State Department. So I do know that. Okay. So that's really exciting that she's getting some national publicity for this, and hopefully other projects will go on there. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Edward Tomini. I'm here on behalf of Daryl Veligal, presenting the research on scalable assessment in MOOC courses. However, that's just the title, because for various reasons, we're not able to accomplish what we were set out for, so we had to shift our efforts and focus on making the course that was supposed to be behind this more effective and scalable, especially having in mind the fact that Coursera just opened a Chinese market. So we needed to make our course suitable for all kind of audiences from all around the world. To make course more effective, we totally redesigned the structure of the course. Instead of each week all topics, we had 1 week, one topic format. We also changed the project requirements from having a finished project at the end of the course to being project ready at the end of the course. We redesigned our exercises to eliminate the cultural references. So the people all around the world can actually do the exercises intuitively. One of our goals was also to reach out and maximize participation from learners from China. And so we hired a couple of Chinese grad students. We translated the whole course in Chinese, all the materials except the exercises. We also did heavy promotion in Chinese social media and post a lot of material there. Now the result of all that effort was a great positive feedback on the new course format. And we also had, interestingly enough, we had learners signing up pretty much all the way to the until the last day of the course and submitting the exercises until the last day of the course. To the forums just for feedback, not necessarily for grading, because obviously the course was over. Also, another interesting thing was that feedback from Chinese learners suggested that this was their first exposure to this kind of concept of creativity and innovation and change. Another interesting thing is the numbers, the demographic numbers. We had 60,000 students from 185 countries, and 45% were students from Asia. The distant seconds were North America with 24%, and the quarter of our students were from China, the second was US with 19%. So very interesting numbers there. And 51% was from emerging economies. So the next thing to do would be to analyze actually the whole Chinese experiment and peer review data and see how this worked out in terms of the impact of the course on the students. Thank you. That'll be it.
Hi, my name is Patrick Shi, and I'm a research associate in IST. I work with Dr. Jack Carroll on this project. And our project is to support dialectical learning using Piazza. And then I guess dialectical learning is actually, I guess, another way of saying critical thinking. So essentially, instead of, you know, in IST, we teach a lot of technical courses. So, like, you know, instead of having students memorize the formulas or, like, you know, stuff like that, we would like to have them deconstruct the arguments. You know, for example, you take a statement on why is open access to online learning content a pro good thing versus bad, and then what are the supporting evidence and rationales behind that, and they have to construct that. But of course, the process making itself is fairly straightforward, but there's actually no good currently good structural online scaffolding system for that to support that kind of process. So what we ended up doing is we ended up taking Piazza, which is the online learning Q&A system. But instead of having the typical Q, you know, question, and then a collaborative community to contribute to the sort of the building a coherent answer, we divided up the different panels in the system. So the top portion is actually a classroom full of students constructing the probe. In this particular example, at the time when we deployed this, it was the Prism. Prism was a big thing. You know, the surveillance program that led to, like, you know, a lot of the privacy concerns. And there was a whole lot of discussion about it, and because we're trending and then students were very familiar with the topic. So the top portion, they use it to say, well, you know, here are some of the pro statements related to this aspect of the PRISM program. And then the bottom is people were talking about the con statements. And there's actually a follow-up discussion section that people were kind of actually debating about, oh, what does this mean, like whether this is an example of this. And then the thread component on the left-hand side is actually different aspects that people debate about. So then we actually ran this kind of like we designed the course curriculum, their assignments, basing on using this kind of process to support dialectical learning in a classroom environment. And then we found, for example, the pro, I mean, we divided, see, the pro of doing this is actually students said that they learned more, they were more engaged, and they helped their develop their critical thinking skills. But the cons, because like I said, part of our rationale is in thinking about designing a potential system, how can we, what kind of a future system that we can implement to support this kind of activities. So they said that, obviously it's funny because you think that you want students to collaboratively added like a comment to construct the outcome, but they're very conscious about accountability. You know, they said, oh, I want to be credited with this contribution so that, you know, I can be more visible and to both my peers and my instructors. So then that of course is one of the considerations that we're implementing in our next future systems. And then also Piazza, of course, there's a limitation in terms of, for example, when people are just debating, usually the topic of debate is like, are you debating at a sort of a high level versus very detailed level? And of course, like when you talk about like the details, like lower level discussions, when you combine them into one Piazza post, then that becomes really confusing. Right. So then, so for example, then we are looking for ways to structure the to facilitate the I guess the construction of the arguments in it at various different dimensions. For example, so we refined based on some of our lessons learned. We refined our curriculum and redeployed it in spring 2014. And currently, we are have moved on to investigating the use of text to structure dialectical discussions. And then we have different ways of synthesizing, meaning to have the meta-cognitive level discussions. So for example, instead of just purely the pro and con, they are able to annotate on the sort of a side panel like that, and measuring the course learning outcomes. This led to several different publications. One of them is the sort of we created a design for a next generation system to support this learning. And also we, the second paper, there are two more papers under review. One of them is about the affordances of the technology, and the other one is actually comparing how Piazza is used in for traditional Q&A setting versus the dialectical learning setting. And then so we submitted a grant proposal that's currently under review, and we got actually a PhD student now currently implementing a system, a prototype that we can that we plan to deploy next semester. That's about it. Thank you.
Okay, so we were working on learning teams in a software engineering course. I'm from Penn State, Great Valley, and our courses are for master's students getting a master's degree in software engineering. So we were looking at engineering projects that are, you know, they're complex, so people have to work in teams, and that's why we have many team projects in our engineering curriculum. What we found were that we developed a model that made the team more effective, where they basically got on the same page quicker, but we found the individuals on the teams weren't learning any more than the individuals on teams that did not use our model to be more effective. So what we wanted to do was figure out why that was and how we can have the teams be more effective and the individuals learn more. So our goal, as I said, was to determine that. So we did a pre and post test of the students when they entered the course and there was a final exam. Can I get that off the screen? Sorry. So they did, you know, many steps to the project and, of course, course curriculum. What we were looking at was the qualitative data to determine how we could modify the course as we ran each section and collected data. So far, we've analyzed the qualitative data and found out different things that we could change for the two sections that we're running now. So what we found out was that we implemented this peer tutoring for the students to facilitate the course curriculum while working on the project. From surveying the students, we found that they actually didn't like being called a peer tutor. That intimidated them a little bit, so we changed that to Keystone. We gave them some technical notes to help them facilitate some of the course material, some questions they could ask the students when they were assigned to be the peer tutor. And then we also designed some team building exercises that they did week one. And these were all based on the qualitative data that we collected throughout. So right now we're running the experiment in two more sections with all of these changes. And once we collect that data, we're gonna start to look at the quantitative data to see if there was a differential higher from the pre and post testing, and also looking at the project outcome. So that's all I have. Thanks.
Okay. I'm here to talk about the UJudge online peer review thing. I didn't know that was going to happen. All right. So this is our team. And if you were here last year for our thing, our team is a lot smaller and a lot different. If you go to the website, the COIL website, you will see a picture of Sarah as the PI. Sarah is now a hated Spartan at Michigan State. So I am now the PI of this, and we're all in the special ed department in the College of Ed. So this was our original abstract, and this is kind of what we wanted to do, was to create a tool, some type of web-based or mobile app that allowed students to peer review each other. In special education, special ed teachers, collaboration is a big deal. Being able to give and receive peer review and feedback is really important. So this is kind of where we were going with that, to create a tool that we will make available for faculty, staff, and whoever. Okay, that was very ambitious, and we knew that. So this is how that happened. Not only with a change in team, but what we end up finding out is, like a lot of things at Penn State, there was actually a tool in place for this. It wasn't in place when we wrote our grant, though. It became in place sometime between when we got funded and when we discovered it. And that tool was actually through Turnitin. They have a thing called PeerMark, which does some of the stuff we wanted to do. So we changed our thing, and now we were trying to evaluate the effectiveness and the efficacy of using PeerMark via Turnitin for our students. Did it help them with making peer reviews? Did it help them in their final products and so forth? So thus far, we've had a practice run using PeerMark in a course over the summer. I cannot remember the name of the course. And what it was, a practice run with the team, was uploading projects and giving peer reviews to each other. Then we did it during the summer for students, for them to get a chance to peer review each other on an actual assignment. And this is where we are now. We are currently negotiating with IRB. Okay. And this is our research study that we're doing in a course, hopefully next month, where we're going to take two groups of students, treatment and control, have one group go through the peer mark system, one group do a self peer review and see if we get differences. And we know that'll be challenges, and this is where we are.
Hi, everyone. My name is Anand Thayusilai, and I am representing here today the grant that is run by Jack Madsen. And the title of the grant was Analysis of Factors Affecting Student Learning Outcomes in a MOOC by an In-Depth Exploration of the Penn State MOOC on Creativity, Innovation, and Change. So as you can see, we had a quite large team initially, and we continue to add more team members to it because there is a lot of work that we can do with all the data that we had through the MOOC in the first run when we had more than 120,000 students, and Bart and his team was very helpful in assisting us with putting all the data together and running the analysis that we did. So initially our goal, we had a few goals for the grant, and primarily we wanted to see how some of the variables from the data that we collected affected the student course completion. Then we wanted to integrate the findings from the CIC1 into the CIC2, and then also to write and present in conferences and publish. And the questions that you see there address those goals. So as a result of the work, so far we have had a number of presentations. We have had three panel presentations in three different locations. We had two poster presentations and one conference paper. We have one paper under review completed by Bart and a few other team members. We have one conference paper proposal under review right now, and we're also working in two others for two upcoming conferences in 2015. Some of the findings included, for example, student expectations and plans to watch videos predicted CIC completion. So what the students bring into the MOOC before the MOOC starts seems to affect the completion at the end. Another interesting finding was that non-native English speakers who were fluent in English were more likely to complete the MOOC compared to the native English speakers. And then another finding was forum posts and comments were significant predictors of the completion. And for example, we used this finding when we designed the CIC 2.0 by including close to 100 community TAs to serve to help us with the discussion forums, to initiate the discussions that sprung in the forums, and then make those posts and discussions and exchange and interactions more relevant to the course participants. And in the coming period, we intend to continue the analysis of data that we collected for the second run, which happened this summer in 2014. And as Edward mentioned earlier, we ran a big experiment with Chinese translations when we translated all the materials into Chinese. And at least back in September, CIC was the first MOOC delivered by Coursera which had the largest student body from a group that was outside North America. So we were the first, and we achieved this with all the work that did with some of the Chinese partners that and Coursera partners that helped us distribute the information about MOOC. So and further on, we still continue to rely on Bart and his help with the data, and there is more to come. Thank you very much.
Hello everyone. My name is Jian Xuan Wong, a PhD student in IST. So our research project mainly based on starting the discussion and the interaction on the MOOC forums. So basically, we used three different analyses on starting the MOOC forum discussion. The first one we used is content analysis and group taxonomy, and also the social network analysis. So team member Dr. Jensen, a professor in IST, is my advisor, and Dr. Basel. So what is Bloom taxonomy? So Bloom taxonomy is a classification commonly used for classify educational goals. So you can see in the Bloom taxonomy, it has six different cognitive levels, and which each levels represent a different level of understanding toward a subject or topic. So yeah, so basically this is how. So for the Bloom taxonomy analysis, we first study, identify, and collect the keywords which belongs to each level of cognitive. And then use these keywords to evaluate the learning progress of users or learners on the MOOC forums. And we also talk about that. So also social network analysis applied to analysis the interaction among users on the MOOC forum. In addition, we also use the other software called LOIWC, linguistic inquiry and word count for the content analysis. So like we study the use of emotional tense, of positive emotional tense and negative emotional tense using the forums. So here is an example. We use the social network analysis on studying the interaction among the users. So we first study, identify the user who are frequently or actively participate in the forum discussion. And as you can see here, each node here represents a user and each age represents the reply interaction. So for the top column from left to right is of course the interaction from week 1 to week 4. And on the bottom row from left to right is from week 6, week 5 to week 7. And the right bottom right is the overall interaction. So you can see these active users, they have the interaction is increased among these active users weekly. So and you can see in the last accumulated interaction, most of these frequently participated users are involved in this social network. So that's one. So next step, we are going to use the same analysis and study on different data set, the forum from the creative innovation and changes. So,
yeah. Okay. Anyway, the purpose of this project is to explore effective way to teach in science labs online and using the technology of Google Glass. So we feel this study can be very significant in ways that it addresses the challenges of online science teaching nowadays. Because it's a tantalizing idea to teach science, to offer online science courses online. However, the difficult part is to deliver the authentic science lab training experience on the internet, because the lab teaching is hands-on learning, is experiential based in nature, and the sense of authenticity is hard to replicate. You have to play with different lab equipment in order to get authentic learning experience. There are some existing models. In some open universities in Europe, people are exploring using remotely controlled instruments, so you can control those lab equipment from the distance. The more popular option is to animation or simulation, is to do the animation or simulation. However, it requires high-level programming and can be time-consuming to create. The release of Google Glass prototype prompt us to think about the possibility of using this new technology to achieve our goal. And there are some unique technology affordances afforded by Google Glass. First, it provides first-person point of view video. It allows you to record video or stream it online. It offers hands-free capability, and you can use a voice command Google search. And also, like a smartphone or computers, it gives you a courseware like mobile apps, so you can download the apps you want to use to communicate or collaborate with other students. So we think it has great potential. So the goal of our project is to create a Google Glass supported instructional model for teaching science labs online. And based on establishing instructional design theories, it has those four phases. In a demonstration phases, the instructor can record lab procedures using Google Glass. In the practice phase, students, off-site students and on-site students compare in groups, and the on-site student can be the eyes of the off-site student. They can, in this way, they can doing lab tasks together. During the evaluation phases, they can share their lab videos on Google Plus, and people can critique and comment and give feedback. So we feel this is a feasible way of teaching science labs online. I will wrap up in a minute. So there are some progress. We purchased the two pairs of Google glasses. We have installed and tested different glasswares. And also, we are in the process of working with a science faculty to create first-person point of view videos. However, more importantly, we are frustrated by some of the setbacks, and we want to share with you. First of all, there are limited glassware and unsatisfactory user experience. The video call function is recently removed from Google Glass because Google decided it's not up to their standards. There are no cellular data, so Wi-Fi only, so that's a big limitation, and unable to connect to the PSU network. However, this issue was eventually fixed by assigning a unique MAC address to the devices. So we feel those are some of the things we want to share with you as well. That's all. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Heather Zimmerman, and I'm here to talk about the Tree Investigators Augmented Reality and Mobile Learning Project. So what our project is about is using mobile computers to support learner engagement with the life sciences and learners' communities. More specifically, we're looking at enhancing technology facilitation pedagogy outside in Penn State's outdoor classrooms, the Arboretum at Penn State and Shavers Creek Environmental Center. We have a team that consists of people from the College of Education, as well as the College of Agricultural Sciences and university partnerships with TLT. The innovation of our project is many mobile computer applications provide content in isolation from the big concepts. So we're trying to design both a mobile app and a pedagogy for instructors to use that can support conceptual development, not just provide facts. And we're doing this in the domain of ecology and systems and cycles and networks. To give you an example, this is what our app looks like. Rather than learning out about a tree fact by fact by fact, learners would look at the whole tree life cycle and then touch different parts of the app to learn more. So if a learner touched the seedling, tapped the screen of the iPad, they would then have this screen come up where they could go more information. And the learners could go around and around this cycle to learn about the trees they were seeing. There's also prompts that both the instructor and the apps give to also get people to look up away from the screen. An important part of mobile learning outside is what we call heads up learning, rather just heads down learning where you're only engaging with the screen. Being outside in Penn State's outdoor classrooms are amazing sensory opportunities, things to observe and see, so we really want to capture the richness of these outdoor environments. Our progress to date is we have developed the app, we've got it working, and then we did intensive data collection at Shavers Creek Environmental Center this summer. We also did a smaller data collection at the Arboretum at Penn State. So we engaged 120 learners using our app outdoors. We begin transcribing and preparing the data for analysis. The method we're looking at is getting peers to talk about what they're seeing outside. So that involved a lot of data collection of video and a lot of transcription of what they were saying. Our next step is to finish transcribing. It takes a long time to transcribe 23 hours of video. We have some papers in progress based on some initial analyses. Let's see if I can switch devices here. There you go. We proposed some conference talks. We have submitted a book chapter on the design. And then from our early June data collections, we have a paper that's in revision already. And then we're working really hard to create an NSF proposal. We've been seeking partners and developing our materials. For our last slide, how people in this room and elsewhere can get involved. So again, we've really been partnering with the outdoor classrooms and integrating things into existing programs. We're working to figure out ways that we can scale up our app. Now that we have this app, how do we get into the hands of people? And then we're also talking to science, engineering, and mathematics professors to find out how can we help them engage learners in their research by incorporating their materials into our app. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jennifer Frank. I'm an assistant professor in educational psychology, counseling, and special education. And I'm going to share with you the overview of our RIG, our second round RIG grant using artificial intelligence to accelerate student mastery of effective interpersonal communication and conflict resolution strategies. So what we're really interested in is the problem of bullying, right? And so I work with teachers, and one of the things we're interested in is basically the idea of why teachers often don't intervene, right? So it's a big problem. 1 in 3 students in the U.S. are negatively impacted, and teachers can play a really important role in stopping the cycle of bullying-related violence. But really where the rubber hits the road is a teacher reaching out and intervening with a student. So what we wanted to do is take a look at why so many new teachers report difficulty in knowing how to talk to kids about bullying and the role that technology might play in helping overcome that. So the problem is the traditional way that we teach teachers how to talk with students and intervene with students is through role play pedagogy, which a lot of times is pretty inefficient. So it takes a really long time. It's oftentimes not effective, so it doesn't work for all people, and it's basically inaccessible for distance education students. So what we wanted to do, we put together a team, myself, my colleague Deb Schusler, TK Lee, the brilliant TK Lee, if you can get him, Serena Epstein as our web designer, and two amazing research assistants here at Penn State. And basically we used artificial intelligence to program what we're calling a pedagogical agent, which essentially is a piece of technology used to simulate conversations with young children. So what we do is teachers implement the principles taught in class. So we teach them basic good communication principles related to nonviolent communication, and then they implement those principles in an online learning environment through interacting with this virtual pedagogical agent. The transcripts that the teachers have then are saved, and teachers can review, reflect, and get feedback from the instructor on their performance. And they can practice these simulations as many times as they want. So what we're thinking is that teachers who are able to practice in this kind of environment will show improved self-efficacy in responding to bullying, improved communication skills, and also more fluency in the use of those communication skills. So this is just kind of an overview of what our platform currently looks like that in collaboration with TLT Studio that we built. We've since replaced these little dinosaurs and reptiles here with actual folks. But our vision over time is we've created one so far, one quote chatbot is what we're calling each one of the pedagogical agents. But over time, we hope to create multiple versions that might represent a bully victim, a parent, another administrator. And basically, the student logs on and they select a given individual chatbot to chat with. They receive some case information about that chatbot that gives them a context for what they're responding to. And then this is the simulation screen here. So what makes this work, basically, is AIML, which is an artificial intelligence scripting language. And folks just go through and they initiate the chat and then the chatbot responds, right? Over here, you can see what we wanted to do is give teachers the capacity to keep notes on how the dialogue is going, what's difficult for them to respond to, anything provocative that they came up with, questions for their instructor. And then for the instructor themselves, what they can do is they can pull up each one of these transcripts for a given student. It's kind of hard to see here, but the day and the chatbot that they spoke with, pull up that transcript and then open it up in Microsoft Word and provide like annotated feedback about you handled this really well, you might want to consider saying this here, X, Y, Z. So we've finally completed version one of the pedagogical agent that we wanted to develop. And we have AIML programming of all the transcript dialogues, and we've also developed scripted scenarios for each one of the bullying cases. We've also developed a really beautiful online interface, and the user tracking system and transcript access version one of that has been completed. So far we've completed the first phase of the pilot, and we've implemented it in a classroom management course, and now we're implementing it again with the treatment group to see what the value added is of this virtual pedagogical agent above and beyond just the traditional pedagogy. We videotaped the teachers, and so we're going to be going through coding of the actual transcript, or the actual video coding process. So I'm getting please wrap here. So again, you know, we're reviewing transcripts to improve the AIML accuracy. So it's a pretty labor-intensive process is what we've learned, but it's very doable. And we've revised the interface based on our usability analysis. And hopefully our next steps are going to be developing new and varied agents representing different demographic groups, students, or situational contexts. So we think this could be used for child abuse interviews, talking with children about alcohol, drugs, or sexuality, difficult topics, things like that. So we'd like to expand it in that way. And we're also talking about the possibility of integrating annotated avatars and/or voice simulation. And that's it.
Hi, so I'm Elizabeth White, and I'm working with Susie Scherf, and we're designing a serious game for teaching social skills to adolescents with autism. This is a little bit out of order. So the eyes and face and faces for individuals with autism is really problematic, and previous attempts at computer-based training to improve skills in face processing and understanding information from the eye region of faces have largely had limited success. And so we wanted to create a program that would add more game-based elements to an online educational program where they can sit at home on their computer and play a game. And so thinking about the elements that we needed to consider in our educational game, we had to think about how they would need to discover and use information to support their learning. We needed a storyline and long-term goals. So in this case, our game has a detective-themed storyline where they're a new detective in training, and they have to catch various criminals. And each time they catch a criminal, they complete a level, and they complete various levels across the course of the game. And each of those levels get increase in their complexity and have more and more subtle nonverbal cues. And they get immediate feedback when they interact with a person, and they get rewards for success in terms of completing the maze level. So in this case, they're using the information from the eye regions and body language of the characters in the game in terms of what we completed so far. So you can think about the different levels we can have. So we're starting with pointing and head turns, and they get the social cues get more and more complex as you go along. So she's looking over in this direction in sort of the character models can do those gestures in the course of the game. And by the end, you get down to just really subtle gaze cues. So we're sort of increasing reliance on gaze and goal-directed social communication. So what this actually looks like, ooh, that started right up. So they're in a city environment, and there's flashing cop lights and cars in the background, and they're talking, and Detective Val tells them that a thief just escaped in the sewers, and you need to go and ask for how to get down into the sewers. And then in the sewers, you have to ask the various people in there for direction. So in this case, you go up and you talk to this person, and you ask which way the jewel thief went, and she points in the direction. And then our participant chooses the direction that they need to turn in, and then they actually have to turn their character and continue down in the maze. And then an example from the eye gaze maze, they watch the subtle eye gesture, and then they continue on in the maze. And so we have a large team of people with lots of different helpers across the university who've made it possible. So thanks.
Thank you. So Marcella is not here, right? She wasn't able to join us this afternoon, and I'm on the project with her, so I told her I'd step in. Marcella's really keen, and it reminded me back to the Jack Carroll, who she's worked with in the past, on developing a system looking at how we guide students in the process of developing richer and more valuable conversations. The starting point is that we know that although we're all gathered into one location, we're not necessarily interacting or communicating with each other. So, and we know that in the case of learning, that deeper, richer learning can happen if we've got interactions and dialogues going on. Sometimes in these large group settings, there's a lot of information out there, but it's often not very helpful or very constructive. And so I was thinking back to the one that was talking about Piazza. I can't remember who did the presentation, but the idea of sort of scaffolding and helping learners build an understanding of the kinds of questions and the kind of interactions they should have. And that's what this tool is going to do. So we're going to look at an online collaboration support tool. This is an earlier version that Marcella is working on. She's connected to an NSF grant at Carnegie Mellon. And the idea is that as you look at students having dialogues in a particular context, are they building upon and asking the kinds of questions that take them to a higher level? And the idea eventually is to get to the place where the system can provide prompts that says when you reply, nice job, you're not giving your very helpful feedback. You may consider saying nice job and here is why, or asking a probing question. So to do this, our third partner on this is the CEO of a small company called CoLearner. He's actually based in London. And he's built a system, a tool that allow us to provide the context for this interaction in these dialogues. This tool, by the way, is effective in multiple mobile environments, so we'll be able to use it on tablets and phones and so forth. It's already mobile learning ready. The context that we're going to use is a course that I teach, a non-credit leadership course called IELOL. It's an institute that Penn State and an organization called Online Learning Consortium runs. We're going to use this course as a place to test this leadership development conversation over time. We're hoping to take that information then and embed that back into strategies where faculty are using group-based conversations that then could allow these the collaboration and interactions in those groups raised to a higher level. So right now we're at the very first, this project was just funded in the spring. We are looking if other people are interested in participating in a pilot study with us. We'd be very open to other courses joining us as well. Okay, thank you.
Okay, hi. My name is Adelina Christova, and I'm really happy that I'm the 20th here because I already have spotted some people that I would like to collaborate, and that our work really ties together. And thank you, COIL, for organizing this. So we did start with the ambition to understand what is going on, and if we design actually groups in one of the open MOOCs, of course, and one of the most popular here, I see it, it's the CIC Massive Open Online Course. So this was what we wanted to do. We wanted to form, actually, with a specific aim to form groups in one of the MOOCs, build learning communities, actually, and study effects of this group on the retention and the success and performance in the MOOC. Beautiful, handsome, and smart team. And it's still open team, so we believe in openness and sharing. So we have graduate students, undergraduate students, professors from around the campus, and now some of our graduate students could not participate. Maybe they're watching us online. So what's the innovation? Our innovation is exhibited in these three points here. We are testing one tool that was already there, but found out that it's not really working for our goals, and we have the ambition to build one on our own, and I hear some other people are doing this for the future MOOC 9.0. And we are actually testing one of the learning theories, and we are really excited to add to the learning theories here. And the progress, what we have done so far, we have we have collected the pre-course and post-course surveys. We have initially we formed the 48 groups, different types, different sizes, and we've collected the post-grouping surveys. So that's just a glimpse of what we found, and this is something about the gender I'm really interested in. And 9, it's high, but it really doesn't matter, actually. And it's just one glimpse of what we have. That's one of the first things. But so does this matter? It's something that we would like to explore further. So what we're doing, and so we already have submitted, actually, a Google Faculty Award 2 days ago. We are working on publications, and we're planning to apply for European Commission in partnership with Oldenburg University next summer. And these are the opportunities that we would like to invite you. And really, these are the questions and projects, and actually look at the ranking gender as an important. What does it tell us about gender in MOOCs? Thank you.
Hopefully the title will become a lot more concrete in 3 minutes. So here's our team. The people with the PowerPoint halos on are the team that are most closely working on this project, as well as somebody virtually. But this is a picture of all of the advanced facilitation team for World in Conversation, meaning all of those people have gone through at least 3 semesters of pretty intense face-to-face training. So I actually want to ask you this question. I'm actually going to ask you to think about it. So can you picture being in the middle of a conversation between US military personnel and civilians in Afghanistan? What are you seeing? What are you hearing? What are you feeling? What's actually happening? So whatever that picture was, this is what it looks like at World in Conversation. So this is US military personnel. These are student facilitators. And these are people in Afghanistan on essentially a beefed up version of Skype called Blue Jeans. So what we're setting out to do with this project is create the training. So those 2 facilitators that you saw have undergone this really intense face-to-face training that's really hard to replicate online. And so we're setting out to do that. So the outcome is March 6th, we're hopefully going to launch this pilot course, which will be an orientation to facilitation skills. We're not trying to teach everybody everything. An orientation to facilitation skills. And pilot that with a group of 700 students in a social 19 race relations course. And as far as you, if this is even mildly interesting to you or classes that you teach, whatnot, I am happy to take down your emails right here and after or whatever, I'll be around and you can pilot the course with your groups as well. Under time. Thanks.
So I am Brad Tabor Thomas. I'm a postdoc in the psychology department, and I am here on behalf of the PI of this grant, Corelli Perez Edgar, who is faculty in psychology. And our project is called The Design and Implementation of a Mobile Eye Tracking System to Assess Parent-Child Interactions in Informal Learning Environments. So eye tracking technology can give us fine-grained detail of visual attention, but it's usually stationary, so a person sitting in front of a computer with an eye tracking unit tracking where they're looking. And what we're setting out to do is to create a mobile eye tracking system for both children and adults in order to assess where individuals are attending in informal learning contexts. And so at the bottom there you see a 2-year-old wearing one of these mobile eye tracking visors playing with a puzzle. And then in the bottom right, you see somebody wearing the visor looking at a computer screen. So this is a screenshot of the computer that we use to assess eye movements and eye gaze. And so we have a multidisciplinary team that spans the College of Liberal Arts, College of Information Sciences and Technology, College of Education. And the real innovation of the project is to have real-time information as children and adults interact in educational settings that are often so information-rich, and so there's a lot of information that they could be taking in, and we're going to try to figure out what exactly they are using in these learning contexts, as well as to assess the social interaction that's usually going on in these kind of settings. And so the project just began this summer. So far, we have bought 2 eye-tracking visors and have got them set up and working with the laptop, and we're now transferring the use of the eye-tracking visors to a small tablet that can be worn in a backpack for the parent and the child. So right now, we're in the process of technology refinement, getting everything up and running on the tablet. Then we'll set out to test the system in a somewhat controlled informal learning context like a museum, and then out in the real world in the arboretum, and then we plan to distribute the technology and findings in an open source way. All of the tools and software that we develop will be online and open source on GitHub. So we're going to also involve the community in this, of course, in testing and then sharing everything online that we develop.
All right.
Thanks a lot. I'm Anthony Robinson. I'm a cartographer and I teach a MOOC on maps. So my COIL project is actually in response to this map, which is one I made for my class. This is the self-reported home locations of people who took my MOOC the first time I taught it last summer. I'm very frustrated by this map, though. It's really cool, but I want to know a lot more than just where people are from who take this class. And there's almost nothing in the literature about the geography of what's happening in a MOOC in terms of learner engagement beyond X percentage of people came from Y country, which is a really thoroughly uninteresting thing if you spend more than 3 minutes thinking about it. So I want to know, what are the geographic patterns associated with various definitions of learner outcomes, types of completion? Where are all the middle-aged women who took my class? That's a really interesting question. There's almost no way to understand that based on existing data I've seen out there, and we have an approach to do this. Where are the most active forum participants located? What do we know about them? There's got to be something here to geography beyond just the percentage of people from different places. Here's an example of another kind of place that we can explore in these kinds of classes. This is a map of the place names that people talked about in about 100,000 forum posts in the first time I taught my class. So this is a totally different mapping of geography onto the MOOC experience. It signals another area of interest of mine. What I'm working on right now with my RA, Sterling Quinn, we're preparing all the data from my class. It involves geocoding all the IP addresses associated with all the interactions and user logs in the course, which is a non-trivial thing to do. We are now linking all the disparate, messy Coursera databases together into one spatially indexed database. We're almost finished with that. And we're about to start building our web visualization right now, which I'll show you. This is the vision for it. This is the part that I contribute to the project. Sterling just builds everything. So I have something in mind, which I'm calling Mapsive, which is kind of a play on massive and maps. And also the idea, fundamentally, which is to use faceted query and filtering to allow an instructor like me to explore all the possible patterns of student outcomes, learner engagements. Let me filter on the fly forum posts to the top quantile really quick and see how that narrows down the population of people in my class and their types of engagement. So that's the vision of what I have here. This is very ambitious to try to do this in the time frame we're going to do it, but we're going to try. Thanks.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brian Smith. I'm an instructional designer in the College of the Liberal Arts, Filippelli Institute for E-Learning and Outreach. My project still is improving student learning and retention with an adaptive e-learning platform. For those who don't know, basically an adaptive learning platform, the student is in the platform moving through the curriculum, and all the while it's keeping track of data on the student. How long they spend on a page, how long they watch a video, do they watch the whole video, do they get a question right, do they get it wrong, how long do they spend the question, and it assesses, behind the scenes, it assesses the student's mastery of the content as they're moving through the curriculum. And so our goal was to vet a vendor and do a trial run of one lesson in one of these platforms, with the hopes that it will improve student outcome. The team is myself, Kathy Holsing, who's the Director of Learning Design for the Filippelli Institute, and Lynn Johnson and John Hobart of COIL Campus. When I wrote the proposal, I was very excited about it. At the time, I don't think anyone at Penn State was looking at adaptive learning systems. No. I don't know if they are. I don't know how that's changed, but I still feel it's could be a very big part of the future of online learning. The progress so far, we had two original vendors we were very excited about. Newton, that didn't work right away because of their strict adherence to Pearson curriculum, Pearson, Wiley, and Cengage, the curriculum, which didn't fly with the faculty we were working with. And Smart Sparrow, who's based in Australia, everything went well, and we were really excited. And then during the purchasing, we found out that their servers store student data outside the US, which is a huge problem. So things kind of lay dormant for a while, unfortunately. Recently, we looked at two other vendors, Acrobatic, which is a private company that started as a Carnegie Mellon initiative, and Realize It, who basically they don't sell the whole platform, they sell their engine, which then someone else comes in and kind of tools with. They have a lot of partners from like Colorado Technical Institute all the way up to Blackboard. this technology has grown a lot in the last year and a half. Two of the companies are what SmartSpur and Acrobatic are two of seven companies up as finalists for a $20 million grant from the Gates Foundation. So if they get that grant, I don't know how much they're going to care about a little trial program with Penn State, but we'll see. Working with Newton, it's kind of rekindled that due to the department's desire to work with Pearson content with their My Econ Lab program. And realize it, we're still looking at realizing it. Right now, we're still working on a vendor. Next two semesters, we're hoping to finally get the trial for these modules, run the modules in the fall, and then just kind of go through the whole thing. Encapsulate into a whole course, find more funding, try a different course, see what happens. Right now, I'm still unaware of anyone else using this, but if you are, if you know someone who is working with adaptive learning, contact me or use Intro Network. Did I get that right? Use Intro Network. Turn that back in, and we'll see what happens. Thank you.
All right. Good afternoon. I'm Chris Gamrat. I'm ordered a little bit differently in the program. I'm actually was in round one, but because I was in a class, I'm asked to go late. So thank you very much for accommodating me. So this project was a number of collaborators. This is a team from the College of Education initially started off, as well as a design team. And I see a couple of them here. Thanks, guys. This was really great work. The initial idea of the project was to build, implement, and study a digital badge platform to meet the diverse needs of Penn State University. So when Kyle initially presented this idea of COIL grants, he said, sometimes you have to build the thing before you can actually study it. And this was very much true for badges at Penn State. Basically, we had some initial ideas, things that we were working on with NASA grant previous to this, but nothing really at scale or capacity to really meet all of the needs that Penn State might require. So this is really kind of using that as an informing model, but looking at it across all sorts of different requirements. So by looking at that, we started to explore a lot of different things. We went back to the initial badging pilot and started to do research on that. We just have a publication that's online now, but it'll be in like a physical print copy. I'm very excited for that in the British Journal of Educational Technology. That's based on some of the work that we did, largely looking at pedagogical design around badges and some of the implications for that. We'll also have continuing development of the platform. So there's the COIL grant, so that's a component, so they'll be building badges into that. And then we've got an external grant. This is a subcontract through Texas State University that will be a 5-year development of digital badges and implementation along the way, recognizing teacher professional development across the country. So that, I think, will also contribute to developing the overall platform. And I'm very optimistic to see that a lot of the same things that Texas State and NASA will want will also be things that Penn State will want. So I think that that's really going to help build the platform and flesh it out into the future. So some of the next steps. There's been a lot of collaborations. We're continuing to work with NASA. I've been working with Badge Alliance pretty heavily. That's a kind of an extension of some of the online communities that are building up around badges. And their six-month first sprint just finished, and they kind of reported out on a lot of the results on that. To learn more, you can go to Yammer and find out about their report. There's a lot of information. I would encourage you to go to the Digital Badges at Penn State Yammer group. That's where I'm posting most of my stuff. And I think it's a really great way to kind of keep up with what are things that you can do in that. And then finally, I'm also starting to work with Michigan State, Indiana, and Purdue to see what they're thinking and doing. Thank you very much.
I'm Stephanie Shields, and we are round two, I believe. I was also teaching this afternoon. Okay, so our team is a small team, and you've seen Marcella on a lot of teams. What we are doing is translating a theoretically grounded, empirically based board game, so paper, into an online multiplayer learning environment. So what we want to do is take something that has been is theoretically grounded and empirically tested, put it in a digital environment, and then see what works better in the digital environment, what does not work as well in the digital environment. Our outcome so far is that we've broken down the game, articulated the goals, and identified stakeholders and so forth, taking everything apart so we can build it back up. And we've identified the information and procedures that are really intrinsic to the game and make it successful. We've used collected information to produce a set of requirements for the digital version. We've also presented at least an initial part of the project at American Psychological Association. Our next steps, we're working with the Educational Gaming Commons to develop the digital version. Unfortunately, the programmer we originally had got a better job, so we have to live with that. And then we will conduct a pilot of the utility of the digital version, comparing it to the board game version. And our ultimate goal, not our ultimate goal, but one of our goals, is to build on these pilot results and prepare an NSF proposal. So
let's see if this one will crash. So this is called Digital Divide. We are pretty much looking at MOOCs, and they're really great for some topics, but not so great at others. For example, if you want to do programming or history or whatever, it's great, you can just get in there. But if you want to do something hands-on, you really can't interact through MOOC like that. So here is a demo we're working on. We're combining things such as gameplay like Minecraft or Half-Life, and combining that with the Oculus Rift virtual reality software to work on the game. And I don't know if it's frozen or not. No. But this is just a quick demo we filmed with one of our programmers on the left, on the right. So pretty much breaking it down to what you want in an office, very simple one. You want it to be a very nice looking place, but you really just need a desk to work at and some things to work at. I think he's going to walk forward through. Don't look at that. That wasn't supposed to be there. But yeah. So right now you can just pick up objects and move them around. This, I think he's using a PlayStation controller, but there's a keyboard and mouse support and everything else. So we have a online store that's in development where you can download crowdsourced objects. Here are just some examples of still work in progress. So here he's going to select the record player to download and load into the game. There it is. You can take it apart. In this case, just take the record off. So depending on the complexity of the objects, you can tear it apart a lot or not much. You're just going to put it down and load up another object. So again, just go into the menu, click on an object, download it. And for example, in this case, you want to learn about construction. So you can attach objects together and they interact. I'm not exactly sure why you want to put a fan on top of a record player, but you can. So I guess one of the big things is we're in a virtual lab, so you really can do a lot of things that you wouldn't normally do. For example, load in a space shuttle and just toy around with that. So I guess that's about it. I guess it is a disclaimer. We've only been working on this for about a week now, and we hope to finish it, but we hope to make it better by the time it's actually complete.
Well, folks, I really, really appreciate your time and energy this afternoon. Just let me leave you with a couple of things. First of all, particular thank you to Brad Stednick and Haley and Patty sitting up front here for organizing this and managing all of this. Also, they're really the brains behind. If you look at the back table there, they've been really working hard on getting some materials that represent who COIL is. We'd love some feedback on that, but that group really works hard every day on making the unit sort of visible and active. So special thanks to them. Also, yeah, please. They do great stuff. It's so much fun working with this team. Also, real quick, keep in mind, and Craig left, and I wanted just to have him say a word or two before he left, but if this program and this center has been helpful to you in your research, please take a moment and just send a real quick email. Craig Weideman, David Monk, Dean of the College of Education, Mary Beth Rosen in IST, and Kevin Maroney in ITS. So whoever, which one of those sort of connects with you, or you can do all four if you wish, let them know, because they're the ones really putting the resources and the energy to keep this group going. Hopefully what happened today is you like watched things, you went, oh dang, I need to be talking to so-and-so because that's something similar to us, or I need to be talking to Robin about structural equation modeling because we need that in our project. That's what this day is all about. It's hoping to make some of those connections. Thank you to Kyle for, boy, he was a dog on this one, man. He wouldn't let us go until we got info networks up and running. So that thing is now working. It's really cool. I think it's going to be a great tool for COIL and for other projects to be able to use and build that network. And hopefully some of the things we saw today, some of that idea about networking, will come out in this tool. And we'll be able to do some of this virtually. So thank you so much for your research and your efforts on this. It's been wonderful. One last thing I'm going to tell you. Last year, if you remember at the end of this day, we had an evening program. It didn't work out this year for a number of reasons, but it's actually quite fortuitous. We're going to build a COIL research event. We're not sure what it's going to look like. As part of the TLT program this year, so the Friday evening of the TLT, which a lot of us go to, and I hope you have that on your radar screens, great event. That Friday event, we're thinking about creating some sort of a research sharing activity, a very active and engaged program. We'll have food, of course. It'll be, hopefully it's something that you bring your friends and your colleagues to. It would be a great problem if we had too many people. You know, if we had 200 people that we had to feed, that would be a great problem to have. I'd love to see that. Angie Dick, who's not here, she had to go back, is working with us, and Jackie Ritzko, who a lot of you know. So it's March 20th, if I remember correctly, at Friday evening. Put that into your mental. And by the way, the TLT just released a call for papers for the event, for the symposium, I think it was like today or yesterday. Open Innovation Channels challenges went out. So great stuff happening at Penn State, and it happens because of you and your dedication to Penn State students. So thank you.